Listening Library presents Crazy, Messy, Beautiful by Carrie Arcos. Read for you by Michael Crouch. The Infinite Ache. Her name was Ella. She had no other name. Ella was first, middle, and last, readily on my tongue and mind. She was older than me, and a good head taller, but that didn't matter. She was my world from 8 a.m. to noon, Monday through Friday. During class, Ella pulled me, as if with an invisible string, from stuffed animals to picture books to swings to a small sandbox. I killed dragons. I rescued cats. I held babies and played house. I was the prince to her princess. We celebrated with feasts of crackers, both goldfish and graham. We shared cut-up apples and slices of oranges like they were candy. We visited outer space on secret missions. We explored uncharted lands. The truth was, I would have traveled with her anywhere. My Ella. I can still see her. Straight shoulder-length black hair, bangs like freshly cut grass across her forehead, her brown arm in a cast during those last months, wide smile with two missing front bottom teeth, her blue flowered dress dirty from playing, her knees red and skinned from falling off her scooter, broken scabs scattered across to reveal smooth white scars underneath. Like all tragic love stories, she left me. For kindergarten at a different school. On our last day together, Ella gave me a kiss on my cheek. I was embarrassed and ran and hid from her, refusing to come out and say goodbye. I never saw her again. I blame Ella. She was the one who first showed me what a terribly beautiful and cruel thing love could be. I also blame the poet. He gave words to my anguish and made me acutely aware of this infinite ache, a deep soul longing that came sometimes in the dark and lingered in the light. His words picked at a wound I didn't even know was there until I read them. Now it's impossible to close. But Ella. Ella opened my heart and then broke it. Maybe I've been trying to fix it ever since. Number 8. Being named after a famous dead Chilean poet is not ideal. First of all, when you introduce yourself, everyone's like, "What?" And you have to say your name at least twice for someone to get it right. It usually goes down like this. "My name's Neruda." "Wait." The person leans in closer. "How do you say your name?" "Neruda." Neruda. Interesting. Interesting really means weird, but people try to be polite, unless they have no social skills at all, and then they just come out and say, "What kind of name is that? Does it mean something?" Of course it means something. All names have meaning, moron. My parents didn't just come up with it from a stupid internet search either. Then there's the occasional person who's actually heard of the name. Those people say this phrase every time. "Neruda, like the poet?" "Yes, Pablo Neruda." Here's the thing, though. Neruda wasn't even his real name. Pablo Neruda was actually a pseudonym for Neftali Ricardo Reyes Basualto. Neftali came up with the pen name when he was a teenager to hide his writing pursuits from his dad, who wanted him to become something more practical, like a businessman or an accountant. Let's just say I'm grateful he changed his name. Latin people have a thing for long names. It's because we take on the surnames of both parents, with the mother's name going last. You just keep adding on names. You can trace our genealogy through the last name, going back generations. Since I'm technically only half Chilean, on my dad's side, I was spared a long, complex name, and am simply Neruda Wayne Diaz. The Wayne is after my mom's dad, who lives in Ohio. But to most people, I'm just Neruda. In Pablo Neruda's lifetime, he wrote a ton of poems, many of them about love, but also about everything in between life and death. And he was even awarded the Nobel Prize in Literature. He was also a communist, which is always a bad thing to be if you're an American. But if you study Latin American history, you can kind of understand it. He died on September 23, 1973, 12 days after a violent military coup in Chile, way before I was born. Every now and then I'll get a devotee, someone whose eyes flame like a zealot's when he hears my name. He'll speak to me in Neruda's words, as if I should recognize them, as if I'm Neruda reincarnate. I'm given the feverish speeches on how he was the greatest poet to have ever lived. I know that. You can't have a name as iconic as Neruda and know nothing about your namesake. Plus, it's one of the first things my dad ever taught me. While other kids were listening to stories about moons and little pigs and cats with hats, Dad would tell me about Neruda, or the poet, as he referred to him. He said his own dad, my papi, who died a couple of years ago and had emigrated from Chile with his family in the 1980s, had read him Neruda when he was little too. I don't remember papi as well as I'd like to, and the older I get, the more my memory of him fades. When I think of him now, I can recall only a handful of things. That he liked to take long walks by the ocean, do crossword puzzles, and say funny things a lot, like, "Camarón que se duerme, se lo lleva la corriente." The shrimp that falls asleep gets carried away by the current. Every time he said this, I'd imagine a little shrimp curled up in some seaweed and Z's floating upward in tiny bubbles and crack up. He also had very strong, calloused hands. We would arm wrestle, and his hands would easily dwarf mine and win. Dad never could beat him either, not even in the end. Papi used to tell me we'd go to Chile one day so I could see where he grew up. He said we'd visit the white sand beaches and the deep green forests of our people. But he died before we got to go. Lately, I'll hear Dad muttering some of the things Papi used to. My favorite is, "El que no encuentra el amor, no encuentra nada." He who does not find love, does not find anything. I think the poet would agree. I'd like to think that would be his favorite, too. When I was little, Dad spoke Neruda's poetry often. Some from memory, some from the worn pages of his collection passed down from Papi. Most of the time in Spanish. And always underneath the soft glow of the lamp by my bed. Dad read the poet like English teachers read Shakespeare, with love and reverence. He has two photos on the desk in his home office. One is a picture of Mom and me from when I was six. She's hugging me from behind, and I'm smiling up into the camera. The other is a picture of Papi standing next to the poet from their chance meeting in Valparaíso just before my dad was born. So really, Neruda and his influence have been in my family for generations. But even though I have been Neruda like the poet for 16 years, I am nothing like him. When Pablo Neruda was my age, he walked around in a large black floppy hat and black cape, seducing girls like a young Don Juan. Supposedly, girls fell in and out of love with him as frequently and as easily as rain falls from the sky. Because Pablo Neruda was not just one of the greatest love poets. He was the greatest love poet of all time. I, on the other hand, am the unluckiest in love. It's not for lack of trying. So far, I'm about 0 for 7. The names of the girls written on my heart, like the scars I can still recall on Ella's knee. Marisol, Stephanie, Jessie, Angela, Trinity. And Elise. I like to think of them as the preview to a great love story, one I'll hopefully get to tell and live someday. Dad has told me not to worry about it. He says I'm a late bloomer and that it'll all come together for me in college, like it did for him and my mom. But I don't want to wait. I want to feel the passion of the poet's words for someone and be able to say them out loud. Lines where he talks about craving someone so much that he's become an animal, crawling and prowling the streets. Nothing can sustain him. No food, no drink. Only her. I want to know what it is to be that hungry for someone.
And by someone. We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.